Amazon S3 has several different storage classes, and it's really important to understand these storage classes so we can determine the best place to store our data for our specific use case. Now, before we get into the actual storage classes themselves, I want to bring to your attention a couple of important concepts. That is durability and availability. So firstly, what is durability? Durability is protection against data loss and data corruption. Now, S3 offers what's called 11 nines of durability. So 99 point and then another 9 nines. Now, that is a really high level of durability, and it means that there's a very low chance that AWS is going to lose your data. In fact, if you store 10 million objects, you can expect to lose one object every 10,000 years. AWS achieves this by having a lot of different copies of your data spread across different availability zones. So your data is protected in terms of durability from loss. Now, what about availability? Durability means the data's not lost. It doesn't mean that you can actually access it. So availability is a measurement of the amount of time the data is available to you to use so you can actually access it. It's expressed again as a percent of time per year. For example, 99.99%. So when you look at the storage classes, you'll see that durability and availability are a couple of the characteristics of each storage class that you might need to think about when you determine which one to use. So here we go. These are the storage classes. As you can see, the top two elements here is designed for durability and designed for availability. Now, the good news from a durability perspective is there's no decisions to make. Every single one of these storage classes offers 11 nines of durability, so your data is always safe against loss. However, for availability, you can see it varies from 99.5% for S3 one zone IA up to 4 nines, 99.99%, which you get with multiple storage classes. So one zone IA is the lowest availability, and that's because your data is stored in one availability zone. Now, there's obviously different costs associated with each of these storage tiers. So if, for example, the data that you store on S3 is not that important to you, you're okay to lose it, you need it, but maybe you've got another copy of it somewhere else, then one zone IA could be a good way to lower the cost. We then have the availability SLA and then availability zones. With zones, you can see one zone IA only has one zone, that's one availability zone, and then all of the others have three availability zones. Hence, they have higher availability SLAs. Now, as you can see, there's also a minimum capacity charge per object for some storage classes. So that means that each object you store will be charged at a minimum of 128 kilobytes if you use, for example, the standard IA. The IA stands for infrequently accessed. There's also, in some cases, a minimum storage duration, and there can be a retrieval fee as well. The four storage classes on the left-hand side here, these relate to data that you need to be able to access fairly quickly. So, for example, we have S3 standard. If you just upload an object and you don't specify where you want to store it, it will automatically go into S3 standard. Intelligent tiering will automatically move data between different storage classes based on how you're actually utilizing that data to try and optimize it for cost and performance. Standard IA is for infrequently accessed data. Now, you do get a lower cost for storing your data, but now you're going to pay for the amount of data you retrieve. And there's a minimum storage duration and a minimum capacity charge per object. So you've got to account for those. And then, as I mentioned before, one zone IA means you're lowering the amount of availability you get, but again, you're dropping the price point. Another characteristic of the different classes is first byte latency. As you can see, it's milliseconds for several storage classes. Now, on the right-hand side here, we have the three Glacier storage classes. Glacier is used for archival data. This is where you want to store your data at a much lower cost for longer timeframes. Now, Glacier Instant Retrieval, which is a fairly new storage class, also gives you milliseconds of first byte latency. But you've got to store your data there for a minimum of 90 days. And you have a higher minimum capacity charge per object than the other two classes of Glacier. Now, Deep Archive is the one where you're really storing your data for a long period of time. If you have, for example, compliance reasons why you need to store your data for several years, but you're very unlikely to need to access it regularly, then you would put it into Glacier Deep Archive, and it would be very cost effective. With flexible retrieval, here the price point is lower than instant retrieval, but not as low as deep archive. But you can access your data in somewhere between minutes and hours. Whereas with deep archive, it takes hours to retrieve your information.